Okay, good. All right, so let me share now the handout about the infinite. Okay, here, can you see it? Yeah?
Yeah.
And after this, if you like, I can send via email these handouts. But in the, as it were, a list of references which I have posted in the chat, you will find the references to the papers on which I am basing these talks. And then you, if you are interested, you can find the full textual evidence, if you like, or the full references to what I am saying. Okay, so I get a message saying that there are people in the lobby. Hopefully, yeah, Alberto tells me it's okay. All right, so the divine infinite. Before we get to the divine infinite, I will say a number of things on the infinite more generally. So this paper aims to show that a proper understanding of what Leibniz meant by hypercategorematic infinite sheds light on some fundamental aspects of his conceptions of God and of the relationship between God and created simple substances or monads. So I will start by revisiting Leibniz's distinction between a syncategorematic infinite, a categorematic infinite, and actual infinite. I examine his claim after this revisitation. I examine his claim that the hypercategorematic infinite is God himself in conjunction with other key statements about God. I then discuss the issue of whether the hypercategorematic infinite is a whole. There. Comparing the four kinds of infinite outlined by Leibniz in 1706 with the three degrees of infinity outlined 30 years before in 1676. In the last section, I discuss the relationship between the hypercategorematic infinite and created simple substances. I conclude that for Leibniz, only a being beyond all determinations, but eminently embracing all determinations, can enjoy the pure positivity of what is truly infinite, while at the same time constituting the ontological grounding of all things. And as I will say, I think here there is a clear Neoplatonic mold at work. So let's start with the key test I am going to discuss. This is a striking passage of 1706 meant for his Leibniz Jesuit correspondent, Bartolomeo de Vos, where Leibniz writes, "There is a syncategorematic infinite or passive power having parts, namely the possibility of further progress by dividing, multiplying, subtracting, or adding. In addition, there is a hypercategorematic infinite or potestative infinite and active power having, as it were, parts eminently, but not formally or actually. This infinite is God himself. but there is not a categorematic infinite or one actually having infinite parts formally. There is also an actual infinite in the sense of a distributive whole, but not a collective one. Per modum totius distributivi, non collettivi. Thus, something can be stated of all numbers, though not collectively. In this way, it can be said that for every ever even number, there is a corresponding odd number, and vice versa. But it is not therefore accurately said that there is an equal multitude of even and odd numbers. So, what I'm going to do is to unpack this longer quotation. Four kinds of infinite. Leibniz outlines four kinds of infinite: the syncategorematic, the categorematic, the hypercategorematic, and the actual infinite. Of these four kinds of infinite, one, the categorematic infinite, is rejected. So in this passage, at least as I interpret it, and here there is some disagreement, in particular with Richard Arthurs and how he interprets, especially the mathematical infinite. In the passage of 1706, Leibniz seems to join the mainstream scholastic tradition in presenting the syncategorematic infinite as a potential infinite, namely the possibility of further progress by dividing, multiplying, subtracting, or adding. This is my emphasis. So when Leibniz in this quotation says that the syncategorematic infinite is the possibility of further progress by dividing, multiplying, subtracting, or adding, it seems to me that is just tapping in the traditional conception of the infinite as a potential infinite. This kind of infinite, I claim, concerns the abstract ideal entities treated by mathematics. So there are a set of tests in which it seems to me this is pretty clear that Leibniz regards the mathematical infinite as a potential infinite, in which the whole is prior to the parts, and one can go dividing, cutting, or multiplying to infinity, but that is done in a potential way. And now we will see why. Leibniz's rejection of the notion of infinite number, which is again attested again and again, of the greatest number, of number greater than any finite number, is, I think, in agreement with this conception of the mathematical infinite as a potential infinite. In brief, Leibniz, with his rejection of the notion of infinite number, or greatest number, is rejecting a categorematic infinite. As it has been shown, the categorematic infinite does in fact commit to the claim that there is a number greater than any other number, namely to the claim that there is an infinite number of parts, y, greater than any finite number x. On the contrary, the syncategorematic infinite does not commit to such a claim, since it merely states that any finite number x, for any finite number x, there is a finite number y greater than x. So as long as you have a determinate quantity, as long as you have a determinate number that is always finite, and then the sin categorematic infinite is telling you that no matter how great that number, there is one more and one more and one more. That is why it's called a sin categorematic. It's this idea coming from the traditional distinction between sin categorematic and categorematic, in which sin is this idea of this particle which don't have a signification on their own, n or and so on, but acquire a signification only in conjunction with the categorematic terms. Now, so far so good, Leibniz seems to be in line with pretty standard scholastic views of the matter. If you look at Goclenius, for instance, a dictionary which was widely used in Leibniz's time, and Leibniz certainly knew, you find a similar thing, a rejection of the categorematic infinite, embracing the sin categorematic infinite as a potential infinite. But here is where Leibniz goes a step further, or if you like, a step away in a different direction from the accepted doctrine, moves away from the traditional line and introduces a third kind of infinite, which he expressly distinguishes from the traditional sin categorematic potential infinite, in which the whole is prior to the parts and the division is potential. So you start with the line and then you can cut it off again, 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 and you never stop. So what is this actual infinite? The actual infinite, which he endorses, concern the real as opposed to the ideal order. So the continuum is ideal. The mathematical continuum is ideal. But there is another order, which is the real order, in which everything is divided, actually divided to infinity. Although Leibniz thinks of the actual infinite sin categorematically, it seems to me he firmly distinguishes it from the traditional notion, for which in that passage we have seen from the correspondence with the boss, he distinguishes it from the traditional notion for which he reserves in that quotation the also traditional name of sin categorematic infinite. So it seems to me that what Leibniz is doing is distinguishing here two kind of infinites, the infinites which applies to ideal entity, to entities, to the mathematical continuum, which is an ideal continuum in which the whole is prior to the parts and where division is potential, and the real order, which is the metaphysical order, the real, sometimes he calls it the physical order, in which everything is infinitely divided. Nothing is continuous, but everything, if you like, is contiguous, and everything, there is no real continuity. Everything, matter, bodies, and so on, are actually divided to infinity. So it's not potential. So here is already an important, very important innovation by Leibniz. But here there is another innovation, and that is what is mostly of interest to me, is a fourth kind of infinite, the hyper-categorematica infinite, that is God himself. So let's explore God as hyper-categorematic infinite. So by hyper-categorematic, Leibniz seems to mean that which is beyond all categoremata. Here. Namely, that which is beyond any determinate thing, falling under the Aristotelian categories and signified by the so-called categorematic terms which have a signification on their own. In other words, hyper-categorematic is that which is beyond any determination. It seems to me that the metaphysical mold that Leibniz is using is that of the Plotinian one. And here I quote a passage which seems to me very revealing. In the divine essence, things are contained eminently. In the intellect, they are contained somewhat more widely. In essentia divina, res eminenter, in intellectum, aliquid amplius, indeed representatively, because in the divine intellect are represented also the imperfections or limitations of things. So Leibniz is distinguishing here being contained eminently in God essence, and then is distinguishing God essence from God's intellect, where are represented also the imperfections or limitation of things. We will see in a moment why that is significant. Hence it is manifest that all things are in God, omnia in Deo. Indeed, a creature originated from whatever perfection can constitute something complete while excluding another perfection. Complete perfection is that which involves all that can coexist. Okay, so in order to understand what Leibniz is doing here, what he's thinking, I think we need to step back for a moment and look at some pretty standard scholastic distinctions. There are different ways in which something can be in something else, formaliter, virtualiter, and eminenta. Now, why is it important to distinguish these different ways to be in God? Is because typically the scholastics would like to avoid pantheism. Because when you say that everything is in God, all things are in God, and somebody as important as St. Paul says things like that, obviously the quest begins for explaining what it means to be in God, what it means that all things are in God, while preserving the distinction between God and creatures. And so these are the tools the scholastic come up with to be in God. One can be in another thing, formally, virtually, or eminently. Now, in particular, interesting to see this further distinction between formaliter eminenter and eminenter virtualiter. So perfections are simpliciter in God formaliter eminenter. So they are in God according to their own essence, to their own form, that is what it is to be in something else, formaliter, formally, but also eminenter, because they are there to a greater, more full extent than anywhere else. So any perfection considered a simpliciter is in God formally according to the very nature of that perfection, but in a better, greater, more full version. However, perfection secundum quid are in God eminenter virtualiter. So perfections, not simpliciter, but perfection which are perfection only in relation to something. And these are the perfections of creatures, which are limited perfection, are perfections only in relation to a certain kind of creatures. So they are in God not formally, not as they are in their essence of being limited, but they are in God virtuality, but in an eminent way. So we will see that Leibniz adopts a version of these distinctions. So let's look at another distinction which is important. Or if you like, let's look at what is the relationship between infinite and absolute. An absolute lack of composition, which is nevertheless compatible with having parts eminenti ratione, seems to be for Leibniz the hallmark of real or genuine infinity in its full metaphysical rigor. And here is a quotation from a letter to Bernoulli, and then a quotation from the Nouveaux Essais, in which we find this idea. Leibniz writes, "The real infinite is perhaps the absolute itself, which is not composed of parts, but comprehends having parts eminenti ratione, and as though perfectly." So in the real infinite is the absolute itself, and what it is to be itself is not to be composed by parts, but having parts as it were eminently. So parts are not there formally. In the new essays, Leibniz writes, "Rigorously speaking, the true infinite is only the absolute." So forget of the other three kinds of infinite. Well, the categorematic infinite does not exist. That is incoherent. The syncategorematic infinite is potential, that is not going to be absolute, but also the actual infinite to be found in the actual division of everything is not going to qualify as the absolute, because the absolute is that which is prior to all composition and is not formed through the addition of parts. Being formed through the addition of parts seems to be a reference precisely to this syncategorematic infinite, this adding parts in an infinite way. And the true infinite is not a modification, it is the absolute. On the contrary, as soon as there is a modification, there is a limitation, or something finite is formed. So it seems to me that Here the infinite, the real infinite, the true infinite is the absolute, and the absolute is conceived as something which has no conditions. So the absolute is conceived as unconditioned, lack of any constitutive parts, that is lack of any conditions, because parts for Leibniz are conditions of the aggregates of parts. And therefore parts are metaphysically prior to the collection of parts. So if something is infinite, truly infinite or absolute, it must not have parts. In next talk on primary matter, we will see why that will bring Leibniz to assert simplicity as the property which tells us whether something is a substance. The second key feature is the absolute as unlimited. And here is interesting because Leibniz, there are a set of tests in which Leibniz thinks of limiting as adding a limit. Now, one might think, well, limiting is to take something and cut away, so it's subtracting something. But Leibniz does not seem to think, at least in this set of tests, of limiting as subtracting something, taking away a part, but as adding a limit. He says that the absolute is prior to the limited, and so is the unbounded prior to that which has a bound, since a bound, terminus, is a kind of addition. Absolute is that which lacks any determining addition, sine addizione determinante. So I found that really very interesting. I will say why in a moment. So to which existence is attributed, absoluted, absolutely, that is without a determining addition. So both meanings fall under the broader umbrella of being unqualified, or to use a more directly Neoplatonic notion, being beyond all determination. So I think to me this is very revealing, Leibniz speaking of to be absolute is to be sine addizione determinante, so to be absolute is to be beyond all determination. The moment in which you start determining, you add the determination to be this thing as opposed to that thing, you start introducing negations. And if you start introducing negations, that's the end of the real absolute. As Spinoza and Hegel already noted, omnis determinatio est negatio. Any determination is a negation. And it seems to me that in this respect, Leibniz, Spinoza, and Hegel were working, all three of them, despite being so different in many other respects, in this Platonic way of thinking of things, and in particular this Neoplatonic way of thinking in which the one, what has really intrinsic unity, what is absolute, what is the real infinite, it has to be beyond all determinations. As Leibniz puts it once, it has to be hyper categorematica, beyond the categorematica, while at the same time embracing eminently the richness of all determination. But determinations must not be there formally. If they are there formally, you are introducing a negation, and that's no good. So let's see now for a moment how this conception of the infinite, the absolute, the hypercategorematic infinite relates to something else Leibniz says about infinity 30 years before the quotation from the letter to the boss. And this is in a set of papers from the Summa Rerum, in a period in which Leibniz is particularly tempted by Spinozism, and by Spinoza. Leibniz is reading Spinoza, and this is perhaps the period in his life in which he's closer, more tempted by this view, for reasons which are easy to understand. So totum omnia and 3 degrees of infinity. One may wonder, according to Leibniz, whether the hypercategorematic infinite qualifies as a whole, as a totum. And here there is competing textual evidence. So is the hypercategorematic infinita a whole, a totum? Now let's look at these 3 degrees of infinity proposed by Leibniz in 1676, and their relationship to the 4 kinds of infinite outlined in 1706. So Leibniz says that there are 3 degrees of infinity. Omnia, God as unus omnia, one everything, that is containing the requisites for the existence of all other things, maximum in entity. Then below that there is a maximum, omnia sui generis, everything of its kind. Infinity, I think Leibniz is thinking here as Spinoza, of the infinity of the divine attributes. And then there is the infinitum in its lowest, infimum degree. This is a syncategorematic, this is the potential infinite, which applies to numbers or ideal entities. So as I said, there is some textual disagreement, tests, as often in Leibniz, pulling in different direction, but it seems to me that the question of whether the hypercategorematic infinite qualifies as a totum, as a whole, overall should be answered in the negative. So the hypercategorematic or divine infinite is not a whole, at least as long as Leibniz is thinking, as he normally does, of wholes as having parts or implying divisibility. So as long as Leibniz is working with this usual conception of wholes as having parts and implying divisibility, I think the hypercategorematic infinite, the divine infinite, cannot be conceived as a whole. Hence, the true, absolute, indivisible infinite is one, but it is not a whole. And here is a letter to the boss. And I found this very interesting for a number of reasons. Well, maybe we will talk about it when we discuss pure positivity and so on, but it goes, for instance, against a certain conception of monism, according to which the whole is prior to the parts, and therefore the order of explanation is said in this sort of version of monism, and therefore parts are the order of explanation is from the one to the parts, not the other way around. Well, Leibniz will stop straight away there, saying, well, one thing is to be a whole, and one thing is to be one. So you cannot just say that the parts are or the whole is metaphysically prior to the parts, and then say that the parts are explained by the one, because whole and one are two different things. Likewise, it can be said to be omnia, the divine infinite, only if all things are conceived as contained in it, eminently but not formally. So the determination of things, parts, cannot be there formally, but they are there eminently. So let me now come to the last part of my talk, and the relationship between the hypercategorematic infinite and created substances. Let's turn to Leibniz's rather puzzling conception of creatures as infinite. Now, there are several senses in which, according to Leibniz, creatures can be said to be infinite. One is the one we have already seen, that according to Leibniz, any bodies are actually divided to infinity. So there is this sense in which a creature is infinite, this actual infinite division of bodies. But this is not the sense I am going to discuss nowadays. That has been discussed in other literature. It has been shown, for instance, that according to Leibniz, bodies as infinite aggregates are not wholes either, because of Leibniz's conception of wholes, as they can a whole as a collection can only be finite. Anyway, that is been discussed in other literature. I will like to focus on a sense of creaturely infinity, which does not imply division or divisibility, since it concerns simple substances or monads. So this is a sense of infinity which concerns what Leibniz for sure regards as substances. We can discuss whether Leibniz regards also corporeal substances as proper substances or not, but in any case, a simple substance, monads, whatever else, are substances for Leibniz. And here is a quotation from a letter to Pierre Bayle. I don't know whether it is possible to explain the constitution of the soul better than by saying, one, that it is a simple substance, that is what I call true unity. Then there is a two and three, we are not concerned now with that. Four, that the soul is an imitation of God as much as is possible to creatures, that it is like him, simple and yet also infinite, and envelops all true confused perceptions, but is limited as regard distinct perceptions. whereas everything is distinct for the supreme substance from which everything emanates and which is the cause of existence and of order and in a word, the ultimate reason of things. These are familiar claims in Leibniz. God contains the universe eminently, and the soul or the unity contains it virtually, being a central mirror, but active and vital, so to speak. One can even say that each soul is a world apart, but all these worlds harmonize and are representative of the same phenomena reported in a different way. Now, the difference between God and created substances ultimately reduces to one, but to Leibniz's mind, crucial difference. Unlimited versus limited perfection. Ultimately, the ontological distinction between God and creatures is based on what Leibniz regards as the strict incompatibility between God and any negation or limitation. Because any limitation is a kind of negation. Any determination is a kind of negation. Being a negation is what is really the problem. The limitation of creature or created substances manifests itself as a limitation of distinctiveness of perceptions, not as a finitude of the number of perceptions which any given monad can embrace. As God, the monad contains the entire universe. The perceptions of monads are infinitely many. However, God contains the universe eminenter by containing the requisites of all things, that is, all purely positive qualities or perfections. And thence it is the ultimate reasons of things. A monad contains the universe virtualiter and merely mirrors all things. So here we see that the distinction between eminenter and virtualiter. To conclude, Leibniz draws a fine line between being limited and being finite. Strictly speaking, creatures for him are limited rather than finite, since through its confused perceptions, each individual substance involves the infinite. It seems to me that the crucial feature which seems to keep created substances from matching the absolute infinity of God is not, after all, indivisibility, also monads are indivisible, or simplicity, also monads are simple. It's not even activity, because also monads are active, but the lack of pure positivity which comes with any limitation, with any determination. Only a being beyond all determinations, but eminently embracing all determinations, or as at one point Leibniz puts it, the hyper-categorematic infinite, can enjoy the pure positivity of what is truly infinite, while constituting the ontological grounding of all things, omnia. Moreover, Leibniz seems to need some version of the Neoplatonic one, so this being beyond, according to the Neoplatonic one, is beyond being, is beyond any language, because with language, at the moment we start determining what is that, we are introducing a negation. That is why the one is ineffable. But not only that, not only the Neoplatonic one, but Leibniz seems to be availing himself also of a distinction between one and intellect, as in Neoplatonism, in order to protect the pure positivity of the divine essence. And here I would like you to go back to the quotation from the text from Brouard, in which Leibniz was precisely making this distinction between the essence of God, which eminently contains omnia, and the divine intellect, which representatively represent also limitations and negations. In so doing, Leibniz finds also a way to distinguish God and creatures and narrowly escape pantheism. Why he narrowly escapes pantheism? Insofar as the divine essence cannot formally contain any limited perfection, limited perfections require distinct substances as their bearers. The lack of any negation and hence limitation is what I propose ultimately distinguishes the divine nature from the nature of created things. So this is it, and now let me stop sharing my screen. So this is it for this first. Hi, Oad. I see Oad has appeared on my screen. And now I look forward to discussing these matters. What I will propose to do is two things. First of all, let's have a 5 minutes break. And then let's reconvene in 5 minutes. What I would suggest is that you write a question or comment in the chat. So don't write the whole question, but in the whole comment, just say Q or C, because this will give me the order in which questions or comments are, as it were, announced. And then I will have my list and call various people to intervene. I also suggest that we follow, at least what we do in my department, is that we have a system of hands and fingers. So a question is a hand. If you have a follow-up comment or question directly related to what has just been asked or directly related to a comment which has just been made, just write a finger in the chat, and the fingers trumps hands, but there must not be abuse of fingers. So I think mostly of you will be familiar with this, but if you are not, this was the explanation. Okay, so may I suggest that we break for 5 minutes and we reconvene in 5 minutes at well, on my clock is in the UK is going to be 3:20. I don't know what time it will be in your time zone. Okay, so see you in 5 minutes.
How are you, Howard?
Stefano.
Andy.
Hi, how are you?
Yeah. I'm glad to see you. I know that
Well, it's okay. But I so regret that I couldn't. I missed a long chunk of Maria Rosa talk. Do you have the what she presented and the
no.
the
No, I not. There is also a record made.
Yeah.
But anyway, we can also ask Maria Rosa to.